Hello, and welcome to Remembrance of Parties. I was in the army and for 24 years and working all around the country. And when I finished the army, I came back up into Manchester in 2018. Actually, about November, October, November, I moved back into this house, and we were full of boxes. Now, what happened over previous years is my father had been holding Christmas parties, and we would attend, not every year, but most years, for myself, me and my family. And we would attend the families. It was a great big meal and really good fun. And chits and chats, you know, that type of thing. And we're on this particular time, he was saying that he wasn't going to do it anymore. And I thought, oh, well, I will take up the gauntlet. Oh, yes, I will take up the gauntlet. And so I set to prepare for dinner for approximately 18 people and or more. And so in my tiny kitchen, and with boxes still needing to be unpacked, this was set to. So I created a nice cranberry and chicken pie, and we had roast potatoes and all that good stuff. I had Yorkshire puddings. It was a great good old meal it was, and desserts as well. We bought desserts in, so we probably got them from the local supermarket because we just didn't have the time to make. Well, actually, one of the big things was I was going to make some desserts, but I couldn't find the scales. And by this point, it was like Christmas Day, and there was no way I was going to get any scales on Christmas Day. You know, these are the problems when you're moving house, of course. So, like I said, we bought cakes from the local, wherever that was. I don't know where. And there was soup as well, so that went really well. And at the end of all the meal, in 2018 this was, at the end of the meal, I didn't plan any entertainment. It just seemed very drab, with everyone squashed into this little room of mine, my front room. It just seemed drab, and I thought, oh, I've got some Trouble Pursuit cards in my bag, which I'd been carrying around for work purposes. And so I pulled them out, and lo and behold, it was really quite dry and didn't really go down too well. In fact, so much so that everybody left pretty much and went back to their granddad's house, where they played some more modern games with mobile phone stuff and stuff. So that all went well. Anyway, the next year coming around, 2019, I was going to be adamant now that I'm going to ramp up the fun, you know, the entertainment. So this time round, same amount of people coming around, and I did a roast chicken and roast turkey slices with Yorkshire pudding, lashings of gravy, two soups. I made a big cake. I tried to make it into a mug, but I did it too late. I hadn't learned the lessons of doing that type of baking too well, and it was a half job done, really. You know, chopping up the cake and serving it out, everyone liked it, so it was very nice. In fact, somebody commented on how good my cream was. thank the cows, of course, and their milk. So that went on fine. We also did some Christmas carols on that day, and we also set a challenge that the nieces and nephews should get to know themselves, not themselves, know each other better. And so they had like a 2 minute or a 5 minute window to have discovered as much about each other and then present it as like a speech or a lecture about the other person, you know, a very small lecture, that being so. And then I had a game for them. Now, this game was called Play Your Cards Right. Okay, and this used to be a TV program on the television where they would get cards. Now, the cards that you get might be about this size. You know, that's how big a good old pack of cards would be. Okay, but for my job, I made them like three times as big, you know, and wide. And sorry, I've got a cat on me. There you go, I'm trying to eat my cables. There you go, good cat. And also I got them to have so I made them up, I got the cards printed on them, and on the back, you know, like you get the label of the cards or whatever. Well, I made my own card. I made it Remi. Remi is the royal, the Remi, they fix all the vehicles and stuff in the army. Well, sister's husband, he used to be in the Remi, in the military, years and years ago, and so this was a homage to him, not that I think he noticed on the day. So these cards, and I made, so what you have a row of cards, all facing the away, to the wall, and what I did, I made four lines, so there's four lines, so four people could play it at a time, and before they could have a go, they had to answer a question. So one of the questions was, why did the chicken cross the road? Another question was, what disease did cured ham actually have? Yeah. And then another one was, if corn oil is made from corn and olive oil is made from olives, what is baby oil made from? So they had all these silly jokes at the beginning of each. They had to answer the question of those, and then they had to choose, was the next card going to be higher or was it going to be lower? And they also had points where they could multiply, bet the points higher or lower, how much of the points to increase the amount they had. And obviously if they lost, they lost a load of points and gained. Come on. Anyway. So they carried on the game, and that was a joy. I think it went on really well, and people were shouting out the answers of the jokes, or suggesting answers to the jokes, everyone along, and it was a real good jovial moment. Well done. And so then we had, I had the second one. Now the second one was going to be a parody of This Is Your Life. Now for those people who don't know This Is Your Life, This Is Your Life was a TV programme where celebrities would be interviewed on a stage. They'd be surprised. There was a surprise, like, This Is Your Life. And, you know, they were like, oh, wow, amazing. And then they'd be on stage, and all these people from their childhood would say, hey, do you remember me? We used to cycle down the road. And then it'd be his friend from years ago when they were children walking down the road, and they meet, and then they all sit together on the stage, and all these people come from through his life, his brother, his sister, his mother, his cousin, his first director, his first tutor, you know, all that type of stuff goes on. But it's all factual. But this was going to be a parody. So it's going to take the mickey quite a lot. Okay, and so what I'd convinced my sister, who's a bit disabled, to come with her husband and make sure they stayed for this extra bit, because it's going to be really exciting. And so then when they came, and what I'd done, I had taken this folder, and I had put it inside an envelope, a jiffy bag, and posted it, well, not posted it, gave it to a neighbour down the road. And so that on the night, I knew I could send my brother-in-law to go and get it, and then we could get ready before he came back. That was the idea. So come the day, I said, oh, can you just go and get that parcel from such an address? And off he went. In the meantime, I got two stools out the front, and I gave everybody a sentence that they could say when I was going to tell them it's your turn to say something. Okay, in the meantime, I would have something that was going to be said as well, and this was going to be like a double joke, because the joke was on my sister's husband, but it was also going to be on everyone else as well. Right, it's going to be like a double hit. And so Stuart came back with the, by this point I had a suit on now, a suit jacket anyway, and sat in the stool. So Stuart came to the front and he said, "Here's the parcel." And I opened the parcel and I said, "Stuart, you thought you were coming to a Christmas party, and in fact, this is your life." Oh dear, this is so funny. So, like I say, everyone had something to say, and then I was going to say something about it. So, the first person to talk was his wife. Well, actually, it wasn't his wife. It was my wife, okay? And my wife got to say something like, "He's such a loving man, I love him to bits." At which point I then said, "This is your wife and long-term lover, Hannah." Which it's not, because it's my wife. But anyway, it doesn't matter. "Your wife and long-time lover, Hannah. She's been your Juliet to your Romeo." Oh, hang on. Didn't they die? "Your Tina Turner to your Ike." That was a bit of a wrong relationship. "And your Heather Mills to Paul McCartney." Well, that died. "This summer, for your anniversary, she suggested a trip to Disneyland in America. But what about the kids?" "Well," she says, "when she and the kids get there, they'll send you a postcard." So the next one was going to be from my father. Now my father at this time was about the age of 76 years old. He's quite old, got lots of grey hair, and a hearing aid in one ear, or both, I can't remember which now. And so he sat there and he says, does this pose look okay?" Right? At which point I say, "That's right, I'm saying this to Stuart, the brother-in-law, "That's right, those late night sessions you have been taking were not at the gym, but at the Life Drawing Academy. He is, Boris, your subject. Although, admittedly, he is wearing clothes today." and then I would say to Dad, "What, Dad? Oh, no, your bum doesn't look big in those." And then we had my brother's daughter, my adopted daughter, called Poppy, and she's a lovely young lady. I think she was around 17 at the time. Just a really nice girl. Done some really good studies as of late. So she says, "Strike a pose," or something. And I say, here tonight, just living around the corner, taking a sabbatical from the high fashion scene is Grace Jones. Now, Grace Jones, as you may well know, is black, you know, and Poppy is not. Not that it makes a difference, but I mean, sort of a joke. It is she who has crafted your great dress sense, from your string vest to your pink mankini, which you've told me earlier you have on underneath at this very moment. Nice. You've got to understand, the people sat down, and Poppy, for instance, didn't know I was going to say that about her, you know. And then we go to Joe. Now, Jo is my dad's girlfriend, and I think she was about 74 years of age. Again, quite old, you know, and a sweet little lady, right? And she says, "He's been a very, very naughty boy." And I say, "It's Jo. You remember Jo. We've coaxed her out of her S&M dungeon, discarded the whips and chains to be here with us tonight. She does have a question for you, though. Can she have the handcuff keys back so that she can set free Vincent Gethick. Dear me. And then I had a spare card because we were expecting someone else to be there, but they weren't there. And so this was a so there was no one to read this line. So this we had a message from your doctor, and he says he's got a firm grip of it. Yes, he's got a firm grip of it. And so that's right. This is your doctor, I said. This is your personal doctor from the Radcliffe Men's Health Clinic. He says he's had them put in a glass and analyse under an electronic microscope. He says that he can confirm that they look normal, if not a little bit small. Next one we had was Bryce. And he wasn't there that night, but he should have been. And he would have said, do you like my hair? And I was going to say, yes, it's Bryce, the son you thought you'd never have. Conceived and born sometime during the sheep rearing years, 14 years ago on Dartmoor, he managed to survive and resurrect a hairstyle in honour of you and his mother, Barbara. Now, the relevance to this is, obviously, Stuart used to be a soldier a long time ago. And Dartmoor is a common training area. 14 years ago on Dartmoor. So Dartmoor is a training area for soldiers, current soldiers, who do training manoeuvres on there. And there is, it is said, rather cheekily, that if a man is desperate on Dartmoor and there are sheep about, watch out. The next one was my son, Tristan, and Tristan is about 21, 22 years of age. You know, he's quite a whiz kid with computers, and so he says, in fact, I can't remember what he says. So I said, you formerly know her as Jennifer. But in fact, it was Tristan who, over the internet, convinced you to send all your thousands of pounds to. He wants you to know that with the promise of a marriage and a few more thousands sent to her Zimbabwe account, life will be sweet. And that's, you know, making a reference to all these con artists who trick people on the internet to send money to. The next person was my brother's adopted son, Kai. Now, Kai, in reference, I think he was like around about 19, 20, has a motorbike, and still has a motorbike. But at the time, he had at least crashed it twice. You know, we all make mistakes. But I thought this was quite funny. So he says... what did he say? He says, vroom vroom or something. And I say, he's here tonight, it's Evel Knievel. Now, Evel Knievel, if you don't know, it used to be in the 70s, was a stuntman. And he used to ride a motorbike up a ramp and jump over cars and buses and stuff to land again. I think he may have had a few accidents as well, but, you know, he was famed for this type of event. So, here tonight is Evel Knievel, your motorbike instructor. He's been teaching you not only how to safely move through traffic, but how to text, talk, and watch YouTube as you go. Which is not something you should really be advised to do, but I imagine Kai could probably teach it quite well. The next one was Stuart, the This Is Your Life guy, has two daughters, and this is one of them. This is one called Tash. One called Tash. Full name Natasha. And she's a lovely girl. They're both very sweet and very, very, also very slight. You know, got a small frame about them. And they were, I think they were 18 at this time. And she says, a boom bang, a boom bing, bang bang bang. And then I said, yes, you thought the noise coming from her bedroom was just a TV, when in fact Tash has mastered all the instruments in her room. Now, she's known to have like a electric drum kit in there, and probably a guitar and a keyboard and the stuff. And I don't think she's actually learned to use them, play the ball. But you know, they're teenage toys, aren't they, really? Anyway, so you thought the noise coming from her bedroom was the TV, when in fact Tash has mastered all the instruments on her in her room, and is about to assault the British music charts, starring as Tash Bush, with tunes like Assault the British Music Charts, starring as Tash Bush, with tunes like Don't You Want My Laundry, Don't You Want It, Ah. And then Touch Me, The Sun Always Shines on TV, especially when I don't open my curtains. And then there was the other daughter. The other daughter was called Charlotte. And just like, you know, like I said, they're both very slight. They're not identical, but both nice ladies. Yes, is Charlotte your other daughter? Or should I say, Adam? Yes, 80% through transitioning so far. So masculine, he'll be able to crush a grape. He loves rugby and all hardcore games, and has entered already as a male contestant for the March 2020 MMA Mixed Martial Arts Cage Fighting in Oldham. Now, obviously, Charlotte was quite perplexed that... hello, Kat. Quite perplexed that she was considered to be a man, and did ask me later why I created that for her. Hey, it's random. The next was Harry. Now, Harry was here on the night. He's been a bit annoying as of late. But on the night, he was here, and he got to say, Reamy, Reamy. When I was in the military, that's what the Reamy used to sing to each other. It was like a calling, Reamy, but probably a bit before Stuart's time. So then I would say, this is Harry, your old army buddy. These days, he suffers from PTSD. He finds it hard to sleep and difficult to meet other people. He shakes when there's a loud noise and jumps on the sudden loud bang and sometimes screams on the sound of a plastic duck, of which I had in my pocket, and as I squeeze, quack! He says it stems from a day back in camp in the Reamy. You, Stuart, was making everyone a brew when... What? You didn't make him a brew? How Jack was that? And that's suggesting that not making him a brew, because tissue generation, you know, had caused him some PTSD. Maybe you shouldn't joke about PTSD, but never mind. Let's move on. The next was Helen. Now, Helen is my brother's wife, okay? And she's, of all of them, she's a quite heavy smoker. Well, she was. She's reduced quite a lot now on patches or vaping, I'm not too sure which. But, you know, she you know, she's reduced down a real lot, which is really good. But at the time, I can't remember what she said. But I said, yes, this is Helen. You thought we'd never hear about her. She's your personal drug dealer. She's been keeping you topped up with the wacky backy all these years, but has become a bit confused with your excess order of Vicks Vapor Rub and double dose Viagra. And then there was my daughter Heather. Now, she was 18, I think, or 18 going on 20. And she says, whiz bang. And I say, yes, it was Heather, your estranged cousin. Way back in October of 2003, you thought it was an electrical fire that burnt your house down and made you homeless. Which never actually happened, by the way. No, it was a Mark III spinner rocket delivered through your letterbox. Time heals old wounds. Just to suggest that Heather had burnt his house down previously, which didn't happen. And nearly at the end now. So the next was his wife, actually, Amanda. Now, Amanda, for her part, has had a stroke and is mostly wheelchair bound. She can walk a little bit, but she has a problem with that, and has had a problem with other conditions in her life, and so you must understand that as we go through the next bit. So she says he's been a very good guy and he's done really, really well. And so then I say, for the past 30 years, you thought she was the Mensa Institute lodger. But in fact, she's been secretly assessing your mental state as you rip down the house and garden around you. Just like out of Little Britain. So if you don't know about Little Britain, Little Britain has a sketch in it where there's a guy in a wheelchair and he has a care assistant or an assistant with him who wheels him everywhere to various events. And now he might go to an event and say, I want that over there. And the care would say, you can't go, we're staying here. And the care would like turn his back on the wheelchair and the guy. And the guy would like just get out of his wheelchair and run over, well, not run, but walk over, get what he wanted, maybe it was like a pint or a piece of pizza or something, get back in the wheelchair, and then the care would turn around and wonder how he got the pizza. It was a comedy act on TV. So here this guy is, he's been brought in on a wheelchair, and he says, wait there, I've just got to check with the security guard. And says, excuse me, lifeguard, can I tell you? And as he's talking, the guy's running up the stairs. Oh, my God. He's going up. Yes, so I've got a guy in a wheelchair. He's disabled. I'll need to get him into the water softly. He's a bit scared. And he's talking about all that. And while the guy goes at the top of the top, and he gets to the top and jumps in. All right. And obviously, these two guys haven't got a clue. And then he's swimming to the side. My God, he's nearly drowning. And the guy says, yes. And he's in a wheelchair, and I've got to make sure. And, you know, he's very scared. Have you got any floaty devices? You know, stuff like that. And in the meantime, you see the guy getting out of the water, back in his wheelchair. Brilliant. He's all soaking wet now. And he says, yeah, let's go see the guy. And he's like, what? Why is he soaking wet? And so... she's been secretly assessing his mental state as he ripped up the garden and around the house, just like out of Little Britain. As soon as you're out of sight, she can't resist rewriting your wrongs. Didn't you think it was strange when, after months of time trying to remove the tree from the backyard, you tipped up one day and it was down, drawn and quartered? as if she had gone and done that in his absence. Now, this is the final one. Now, this was my brother. Now, earlier on, I told him that I'm going to shout at him. And that he's, well, not to react, because, you know, I'm not really shouting at him, but it's part of the thing. Now, he had a line to say, which was, "Land of hope and glory, master of the sea." Now, this comes from a TV programme, I don't know if any of you have heard of it, comes from a TV programme called It Ain't Half Hot, Mum. Okay, and it's an old series back in the 70s, I guess, about a troop of soldiers acting as a theatre. To entertain the troops in India or Africa or wherever they were, it was very hot, and so they were always in like shorts and short sleeves and stuff, you know, because of the heat. And they were putting on these plays, and you had some like camp soldiers and non-camp soldiers, and then you had this burly, Windsor Davis is the actor, I think, who was the sergeant major in it, and he would be like barking orders to everyone, in his deep voice. And so the program would go on, and then at the end of the program, there'd be like a, "We're here, the boys are us, the boys to entertain you," and it'd be very musical, lots of stuff. And then that would sort of finish, and then it would end with like Indian music playing with a guy saying, "Land of hope and glory, master of the sea." And when he got to sea, Windsor Davis would be shout. You wouldn't see him, you'd just hear the voice of him going, "Shut up!" And then the music would speed up so right to get to the end of the program.
B-O-Y-S, boys to entertain you.
And that's what would happen on every at the end of every episode, right? And so my brother, he says, "Land of hope." He doesn't sing it because he doesn't. I don't think he. I don't, he probably doesn't connect the words to the series. It's quite a reach. So he goes, "Land of hope and glory, master of the sea." And I shout, "Shut up!" And everybody sat around in like stunned silence because like, what is going on? I then gather myself together and I say, "Yes, he's here tonight. We've spared no experience. We've flown him halfway round the world." I've just got to stop there. My brother's job is part of his job is he's been sent quite a lot of times to India to deal with the Indian part of the business. And so he's had flights to India and then back and so and so. So he's done it quite a lot, all right? And that's what this joke is about. So here we go. "Yes, he's here tonight. We've spared no expense. Flown him halfway round the world at the annoyance of Greta Thunberg. Here from New Delhi, central India, it's Mahatma Gandhi." And as the last were falling off that, I then press play on the TV, and they have the theme music for the "It Ain't Half Hot Mum." "Here the boys are us, the boys to entertain you." Now I'd said to Stuart, and I'd showed Stuart this video, this end video, and I'd previously, and I'd said, "When it comes on, we're going to do a silly jig, a silly dance," and as it came on, he was like, "Oh yeah," and he just started dancing with me and him in front of the TV, this silly dance, and it ends with "Land of Hope and Glory, shut up," and that was the end. And then Party Poppers. Well done, Stuart. This is your life. So that was the end of those two part. Well, no, there's one more. There's one more. So we had a party in, well, it must have been 2020. Now, if you'd remember, 2020 was the start of COVID, and so this was going to be quite problematic, because I realised that the parents, the granddad, wasn't going to come, and my brother probably wasn't going to come because he's got his own conditions, and so lots of people might not come to this party. But you know what I thought? Well, the kids would come. The teenagers, they'll come. Because let's do it. And so I invited my brothers, Poppy and Kai. They didn't come. Okay, they lived in near Hull. It's quite a long distance away for us Brits. But we had Kai and Pop. We had Charlotte and Tash, and we had Harry, who was still friendly at that time, and we had my troop, which was Tristan, Heather. Bryce was meant to be there, but he didn't come that time. He was so he was somewhere else where COVID had happened, so he was in lockdown somewhere else. Or so he said. And then we also had my wife, and we had Hudson, who was a little child at the time, aged, I don't know, 5 or 6, something like that. And so we did. So what happened? I went around to the parents and my brother in my car, and with a camera, filming from a distance away. I gave them tasks to do. So their tasks were, and so they all got filmed, and silly tasks. And one of the tasks was they had a tube with holes in it and a ping pong ball in the bottom, and they had to get the ping pong ball out without turning it over or anything. They had to fill it with water. Well, the idea was they filled it with water, but they had to block all the holes up to get the ball to the top. And so they all had various tries to do this. Poor Howard was trying to wrap cellophane around it and masking tape, and he was struggling with the masking tape because it could just get breaking, and it was very funny. In fact, the quickest person on that was Erin. Yeah, Erin did the fastest, which was really good. You know, she did really well. And Stuart was hilarious. Getting water all over himself, it was amazing. And then the second task they did was they had three cards, one, two, three, and each one had a different instruction, but they couldn't see the instruction until they turned each card over separately. And as they turned over one card said, eat one of the items. Well, the items were a Twiglet, a Weetabix, and a jelly. Okay, so they had to choose which one they're going to do. So one, if they'd have picked up the one card that said eat it, that's what they had to do first. Eat it. Eat one of them. Okay. The second card might have been balance your item. Choose an item to balance on the top of a pole. So it had to get balanced on the top of a pole. So that might be the Twiglet, or it might be the jelly, or it might be the Weetabix. And the final one was, there was a bucket about 5 meters away that had to throw the item from a position into the bucket as many tries as it could do. And it might have been that they were left with the jelly. And they were chucking this jelly numerous times to get it in the bucket, or the Weetabix, or the Twiglet. You know, depending on how they chose, you know, it could be a different ending for each person. And then the final one was that they had a bucket and a piece of paper, and they had to put the paper in the bucket, but in the most explosive and amazing way they could think of.
Wow.
If it can go anywhere, the paper can go anywhere.
Let's see if I can... Nope. I don't know how near I was.
And so they did that task as they seemed fit. And my editing skills got slightly better, maybe, as we went along. This was a really good venture for me. and so with the children here, if you've ever watched the programme, the first scene of the programme, Taskmaster. Did I mention this was Taskmaster? The first scene in Taskmaster is that the contestants bring the Taskmaster a present based on some premise. Okay, so I got with the help of the parents, and I basically got all these presents set up in the room, and temporarily for the first session, which was given the present session, Tristan, my son, became the Taskmaster just for this one bit. And so that he was being given these presents, and once he got given the presents, he had to issue points. Now, one of the presents, was a rather naked Cindy doll, right? Another present was a half-eaten chocolate Santa. Which Grandma Bob had given. Another present was, I got Joe, who's my dad's girlfriend, 74 or whatever, to take a baby and we recorded it as a video from their house. And so she has this baby, and she says, "Oh, the baby's feeling cold. Oh, I think I'll put him in the microwave to keep warm." And so we have it as if she's put it in the microwave, and then, "Oh my God, there's a fire, you know, the baby's burning in the microwave." And so on the day, we see the video, and then we see the remains of this plastic baby. and then we had a teddy that's depressed, but you'll have to watch the video of that, and something else I can't remember. So that went on, and then they watched the videos, all the children watched the videos, and then they had to issue points to see who got the points, who got the maximum points and all the rest of it. And then finally the children in the room had to do their final test. Now again, in the TV program, the final test is done on stage, and they get they have a task to do on stage to see who gets the final points. So in this case here, they got tied to the sofa. I got a chain and chained all of them to the sofa, and then they had a chain, two ends of a chain attached by a padlock in front of them around their waist, right? And I was just about to tell them how to do it when they started trying to escape underneath, trying to lift it up over. I was like, no. The trick isn't to just lift it over your head. You've got to undo the lock, right? Because otherwise that's not an official escape. You've got to undo the lock, okay? So once they were reset, it was a four-key lock, so four numbers on it. And I said, right, so I was going to, you know, I'm going to give you hints on how to do it. Oh, what would they have to do? They escape through my hallway, okay? And so I gave them the first two numbers. The first two numbers were my weight in kilograms, okay? And so they were working that out, and I can't remember what I was then, 55, 65, I haven't got a clue. But it's two numbers anyway. And I was just about to release the second two numbers when Tash had undone her lock and she was through. So she got like the top marks for being the first person through. And then I got to say that the second two numbers are mine and the wife's favourite sexual position. Which is not true, but it was funny. And obviously that number is 69. And so that eventually people got through. Not everyone did. Some people were still struggling. And they got through. And that obviously totted up the points. Now, it's funny, Charlotte getting first out gave a massive boost for the person she was working for, right, which was, she was twinned with Uncle Howard, but it wasn't enough to beat Erin, who won the full contest, right? And so a couple of days later, I went and saw Erin, and I gave her somewhere between 20 and 40 pounds, I can't remember which, as her prize money for winning. So well done to Erin, and well done for everyone for, you know, playing the game in as such a thing. It was great. And so that's what happened then, as one of my games. And the reason I'm recording this is because I didn't manage to get it all on video, especially the early ones. I didn't, and it would have been great if they had been, but you know, memories fade, and such great big events is worth remembering. And I just want to mention another thing. You know, when we did a party before the COVID, my dad, we were doing karaoke with my dad, me and my brother actually, had the volume not too loud, you know, and we were singing some old songs with him. And he just couldn't get it together. he just couldn't get the rhythm right or anything. Anyway, I was taking him home later that night, and he was saying to me, I can't remember what exactly he said, but basically he said it would have been better if there was music playing. I said, there was music playing. Oh, well, he didn't have his hearing aids turned up enough, or maybe we needed the music louder for him. But he couldn't hear the music, and so he thought that's why he couldn't get the tune. Oh, how strange. Well, if it had said, we'd have turned the volume up. Anyway, Merry Christmas to you all, wherever you may be, and take care. Bye.
Here I am again. Only one, pick one card up.
Chicken!
Chicken.
25 years of marriage time,
yeah,
I can do
that. Don't use masking tape, it's crap.
I'd say the jelly's gonna be the easiest. No, I use like a snot sucker to get all the snot out.
Can I have a light, please?
There's a crack in it!
What?
Oh!
Have you got me in colour? Okay.
That is a good idea though, if Harry was here. I'm not sucking that.
Pepper. What?
Oh, that pole!